Hi, this is Jeffrey Reddick, creator of Final Destination.
Greetings, Slashaholics. This is David Bergantino, author of the Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror books, the Bard's Blood Horror Shakespeare books.
Hey guys, this is Jason Brooks, Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th Vengeance.
Hey, this is Slasher Pepper.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, part 6.
This is William Pattison, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris.
Hi, this is Deborah Voorhees from Friday the 13th, part 5.
Hey folks, this is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa.
Hello kiddies, this is John Kassir, the voice of the Crypt Keeper.
Hi, this is Kane Hodder, better known as Jason from Friday the 13th, Victor Crowley from Hatchet.
And you're listening.
You're listening.
And you're listening.
And you're listening.
I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening.
You are listening.
And you are listening.
And you are lucky enough to be listening.
Okay, boils and ghouls, you are listening.
You are listening
to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
The 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
Well, things started getting stranger, and the TV warned of danger, and Chucky said that he was really bugged. Cause it isn't very funny being treated like a dummy, so I went and gave that little guy a hug. But he pushed me away and said, I'm sick of this child's play. No more of a sicker guy from now on. Then I got really scared cause he jumped straight up in the air. Started cursing up a storm.
Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons from the Patreon page. That's Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Carl Leakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Iron Alexa, Allison Sibe, Ryan Woodward, TikTok 12, Bree, Bonanza Jellybean, and Kai Antez. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel through Patreon. And if anybody listening right now enjoys the content of the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel, and would like to help keep it going and growing for a long time to come, then click the link in the description below and sign up on Patreon for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards depending on the tier you select, such as the $2 tier gets you the early access content, the $5 tier gets you the early access plus a free ebook emailed to you every 3 months, and every 12 months you get a free gift from the merch store. There's also a $15 tier that gets you a free gift from the merch store every 6 months, a free ebook every 3 months, and you can appear on the podcast and voice a character in an audiobook narration once per month. So there's many choices to choose from. Just click the Patreon link in the description below and check it out. Child's Play 2, The Novelization. Chapter 17. The building had to be empty, he guessed. All the runts were out here, enjoying the sunshine, polluting the air with their screams. The principal's probably grabbing another cup of coffee, maybe playing hide the crueler, with his secretary. The teachers are probably down in their cancer ward, sucking at Marlboros while bragging about which kid is the craziest. Chucky held the mesh of the fence tightly. I was one of those kids, he thought, in a special class. Had emotional problems, and reading problems, and math problems. Yeah, I was a regular walking mess, with more problems than you could shake a yardstick at. And all the teachers and the aides and even the principal cared about was collecting their checks and keeping me out of their hair. School, he thought. Then he said the word. School. It's a lousy concentration camp for kids, especially the kids that need help. You don't get help in school. He looked at the building. It's empty now, he thought. He let go of the wire mesh fence and started running, dodging between the bushes, checking that no one could see the red and blue blur of his good guy clothes, hustling to the side door. I hope it's open, he thought. He stopped at the entrance gate and, seeing that the kids were over by the hopscotch courts and the climbing toys, he ran. I move pretty good on these little legs, he thought, and that scared him. He thought maybe it was too good. Too good because they were beginning to be his real legs. He got to the metal door covered with chipped and peeling red paint. He pulled on the handle, and nothing happened. But then he grunted and pulled harder, pressing down hard on the latch. The door popped open. He smelled something he hadn't smelled in, what, 20, 25 years? Chalk and crayons, and stale urine from the lavatories where the little boys with their pea shooters end up playing firemen on the floor, and vomit. He remembered kids throwing up in the classes, in the halls. School didn't agree with them. He hurried up a short flight of stairs. In the corridor, he saw a row of doors and bulletin boards filled with pictures. First grade. Andy's in first grade, he reminded himself. He hurried down the silent halls past the water fountain and a glass case with a fire extinguisher. He saw a door just ahead. Principal's office, it said. He heard some clacking from inside, typing. He hurried past it and then past the auditorium. He ran full speed. He saw a door marked 2A, second grade, he thought, and then past that two more doors, 1A on his left and 1B on his right. Which one, he thought. He heard a door open behind him. Is the principal coming? He wondered. He grabbed the door to 1A and then turned the knob. And, as his luck would have it, it opened. He slid into the room and the wood floor creaked. He heard the brats outside squealing and yelling. The room looked like every hell of a classroom he had ever done time in. Chucky waited, listening to hear if there was anyone there. He could see that there were no feet under the teacher's desk. He ran to the chair and climbed up. The desk was neat and orderly with three nice and orderly stacks of papers. Chucky picked up a pile of math papers and flipped through them, searching the tops of the pages, checking the scrawled names. Come on, he muttered. Where the hell is it? If Andy's not in this room, he must be in the other one. He flicked through the Ashleys and the Merediths and the Tommies and the Brads until he came to a paper that had the name Andy B. on top. This must be the place, he grinned. He reached out and grabbed a pencil. The pencil had words on it. Merry Christmas from Miss Kettlewell. He heard a whistle blow outside. Recess must be over. Chucky wrote on the paper, laughing to himself, his strange little voice echoing in the empty room. Miss Kettlewell held the book up to the class, but from where Andy sat, he couldn't see much. He was in his seat, miles away from the front of the room. My old teacher had a rug, he thought. We all sat around her real close, and she was good at reading stories. She made voices and sounds, and When Miss Kettlewell read, it sounded like his grandmother. But Andy listened to the story. It was a good story. A story that, for some reason, he really liked. And the cricket said to Pinocchio, "If you're very, very good and you promise to tell no lies, then you will become a real live boy." The other kids were whispering, leaning across their seats, talking to each other. Miss Kettlewell didn't seem to hear them. Andy leaned forward to hear the story better. And Pinocchio said, "Oh, I will be good. I'll be a good..." Thwack! Andy felt a sudden stinging feeling at his ear. His hand shot up to his right ear, and he groaned.
"Ow!"
as he rubbed it. Rick Spicer was laughing. Andy turned around scowling. Spicer made a flicking motion with his finger, making his middle finger kick at the air. "Gotcha, good kid," Spicer whispered.
"Get lost, microchip,"
Andy said. But as soon as he said it, he realized that he had spoken too loudly. Miss Kettlewell's voice sailed from the front. "Am I boring you, Mr. Barclay?" Slowly, Andy turned to face the front.
"No, Miss Kettlewell."
She had put the book down and stood up. She started walking toward him, each step releasing more words. "I have precious little patience for disruptive students." She stood right in front of his desk. It was Spicer, he wanted to say.
"But..."
he started. Miss Kettlewell slammed the Pinocchio book down on the table. "Especially new students whose utmost concern should be fitting into the class. You know, Andy, I have my good sides. I do." She paused. He could finish her thought. "And I have my bad sides." Andy looked down. He heard a snicker from behind him. Miss Kettlewell took a breath, a long, slow, displeased breath. And then, in the nick of time, the bell rang, and all the kids started scurrying around their desks. Saved by the bell, Andy thought. He was glad to see this day come to an end. Miss Kettlewell shook her head and started walking back to the front of the room. "I want those desks spick and span before anyone thinks about leaving." Andy cleared his books and papers off his desk, stuffing them into the empty hole just below the top of the desk. Then he remembered that he had a Berenstain Bear book from the class library. He pulled it out of his desk and walked over to the bookshelves near the tiny housekeeping corner, filled with a battered toy stove, trucks, and blocks. He didn't see Miss Kettlewell pop open her mouth, but he did hear her gasp. He was too busy looking at the shelves of toys, at the good guy doll sitting on the bottom shelf. That hadn't been there before, he thought. He stood perfectly still looking at it. It hadn't been there before. He knew. He would have seen it. He backed away. "Andy!" Miss Kettlewell screamed. "Andy Barclay, come here!" He spun around. He felt as if he'd fall over, like the time he had a fever and everything seemed to be moving. "Just a doll," he told himself. It's just a doll." "Right, just like the other one," his mind said back. "Like the other one that tied him up. Like the one that's gonna get him." "Come here," Miss Kettlewell repeated, and Andy trudged over to her. He barely saw the other children gathered around the desk, smelling blood, eager to see what the new kid had done to get the teacher so upset. The teacher shoved a paper at him. He saw his name and math problems, and there were words, upside down, words he couldn't read. He started to turn the paper around. "Do you think this is funny? Is this the idea of a joke where you come from, Mr. Barclay?" He could read the words now. "Fuck you, bitch," was written right there on his math paper.
I didn't do that,"
Andy said. The kids watching all laughed at him. Andy looked around at them. He didn't see any sympathetic eyes in the whole lot. There were kids who were used to watching someone get in trouble. It was that kind of class. The bell rang again. "Go ahead, get to your buses," Miss Kettlewell snapped to the class, "and don't forget the spelling test tomorrow." She turned her demon eyes back on Andy while the kids stampeded out the door, to the buses, to home, to freedom. Andy started to move away. "Not you. Take your coat off and get comfy, Mr. Barclay. You're going to be here a while. I'll have the office call your home. You can take the late bus." Andy sniffed at the air, and his eyes stung. They felt full, and he knew he was ready to start crying. "Not in front of her," he prayed. "Not in front of this monster. Teachers like this live for kids crying."
"But he didn't do it, I swear,"
he pleaded. "No, then who did?" Andy shook his head. He thought of Rick Spicer. He might have done it. He was that kind of kid. But when could he have done it? The class had always been together all the time, and... He turned, looking away from Miss Kettlewell's glares, over to the windows, the bookshelves, the toys, the good guy doll. Miss Kettlewell saw him look, and she started moving, her shoes clicking angrily on the wood floor. "No, sir. Don't even think about playing with toys." She went straight for the good guy doll and picked it up by its red hair. Andy watched. The hair didn't look right. It almost seemed a bit loose. Miss Kettlewell walked to the back of the room, to a big closet. She unlocked the closet and threw the doll in. Andy caught glimpses of stacks of construction paper, a kickball, a sweater hanging on a hook. She slammed the closet door shut. "Now go to your desk, and you put your head down while I call your foster mother." Andy went to his desk while Miss Kettlewell slammed the classroom door behind her. He kept his head down for a minute, knowing that she was watching him. Then he popped his head up just a bit, just enough to peek. "She locked the door?" he wondered. "She couldn't have done that, could she? You can't do that to kids. You can't lock them in a room." Then he turned and looked at the closet door. That was locked. He was happy about that. She had locked that nice and tight. He looked at the classroom door one more time. He didn't see her looking in. So he sat up, turning now to look back. Back at the closet door. "It's just another good guy doll," he told himself. It's probably been here for ages. But then why was the hair the same? The red hair looked all kind of funny. He checked the classroom door one more time. And then, very slowly, as if his moving would make a tremendous sound, he slid off the chair and got to his feet, tiptoeing. He walked to the back of the room, looking repeatedly over his shoulder. He moved right to the closet door, listening, hearing nothing. And then he crouched down ever so slowly and put his right eye up to the keyhole and looked into the dark closet. A glassy blue eye looked right back, and a voice from inside the closet said, "Peek-a-boo!" Andy screamed. He rolled back on his butt, hitting the wood floor hard, and still he screamed, looking at the keyhole, imagining that he saw a glint of blue in the black spot.
"Help!"
Andy yelled, and then louder, screaming. He heard his voice echo off the high ceiling. As he sat there yelling and crying, he looked down at his hands and saw that he was clawing at the wood as if trying to hold on or crawl away. He heard the voice again, from inside the closet, sweet, helpless. Andy, please, let me out, Andy. Come on, Andy, it's dark in here. I'm scared of the dark. Please, Andy. Andy clawed at the wood some more. He looked up at the door of the classroom. It looked so far away, and the closet door seemed so close. Hey, Andy, I'm tired of fighting. Let's make up and be friends again. He sounded just like the nice good guys on the TV show. Nice and friendly. What do you say, Andy? Huh? Andy tried to scream, but his voice sounded all dry and cracked.
Help me! Someone! Chucky's here! Please!
And he was answered, from inside the closet. As Chucky, and he knew it was Chucky, started pounding on the door. Pound, pound, pound. His little fist making the door rattle on its hinges. Andy imagined that he could see the wood bulge, splinter, and break. He got up and ran to the classroom door. He looked over his shoulder at the closet. Chucky kept pounding. He screamed, "Okay, I promise. I won't kill anyone else. I promise. You understand. So okay, now open the door." Andy turned the classroom doorknob, but it didn't move.
"No,"
he moaned, and again,
"No."
He kept twisting the knob back and forth, but nothing happened. "She wouldn't have locked me in here," he thought. "She wouldn't have done that." "You heard me," Chucky bellowed. "I promise, you little shit. Now open the door." It wouldn't open. Andy slowly turned to face the closet door. It was the only thing he saw in the room. There were no toys, no books, no desks, no chalkboard. Just this one door with peeling green paint and the terrible thing behind it. "God damn it, let me out." It wasn't a good guy voice anymore. Andy watched the door bend each time Chucky beat against it. I could count, Andy thought. Count to 10 and then he'll stop or the door will just explode open. He heard the sound of a school bus outside, struggling to move away from the school. Andy looked toward the window. He licked his lips, frozen for a second, but then he dashed over to it. He grabbed the metal handles of the window and tried to push it open, but nothing happened. "Andy, open the damn door, or else." He looked up. He saw that the window latch was closed. He reached up on his tippy toes, but he was way short of reaching it. The pounding seemed to be coming faster, like drums or a train picking up speed. Andy thought he heard the wood starting to split, but he didn't turn around. Instead, he grabbed one of the kids' chairs and pulled it close to the window. "There," Andy thought, climbing up but listening carefully to the noise still behind him. "That was definitely wood cracking, breaking. Please, God, don't let Chucky out. Please, God," he thought. "If you don't let Chucky out, I'll be good. I'll be good for the rest of my life. I'll be a good boy." And he tugged at the window latch. It wouldn't move. More splintering. Then another tug. He grunted and it moved sluggishly. "Just enough," he thought. He hopped down from the chair and pushed open the window. It was hard getting the window to move even just a little bit, but Andy used his whole body to push upward on it. With the window open, he smelled the air and a bit of the bus exhaust. He took a breath and crawled through the open space. He was almost all the way out when something grabbed his foot and held it. It was only that his shoelaces were caught in the windowsill, though. He jiggled his foot, the shoe came free, and he slid over the side to safety. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 17 of Child's Play 2, The Novelization by Matthew J. Costello. really enjoyed tonight's chapter, but I'm really looking forward to what comes next. I mean, the book has taken Mrs. Kettlewell and just made her even more unlikable to the extreme. And you know, I kind of have a feeling if the book sticks to what happens in the movie, then I'm going to be rooting for Chucky in the next scene. Well, at least the next scene that Miss Kettlewell should be appearing in anyways. What about you guys? Let me know in the comments section if you're looking forward to Mrs. Kettlewell's demise like I am. You know, what I really enjoy about this book is not just the inner monologues that we get, the thoughts like of Chucky and stuff when he's planning things. I thought it was kind of cool, you know, we got in his head a little bit whenever he's writing fuck you bitch on the math homework or the math paper of Andy's. But also, you know, the book has just really, really made Andy this super sympathetic protagonist for the story. I mean, damn it. This kid has been through so much shit in the first Child's Play. Now he's going through all this shit with Kyle, his foster parents, missing his mother. This teacher's pretty much bullying him. He's got a real bully in the class bullying him. And amidst all this stuff, Chucky's back and nobody believes him, you know? His mom's too far away to help him. And maybe that's what I really enjoyed about the movie. The stakes were so high, and Andy just felt so helpless, you know, and it makes it that much better when the final showdown happens, and we'll get there in the book pretty soon. Anyways, guys, I'm really enjoying the book so far. I hope you are as well. Please let me know in the comment section below if you're enjoying it and if you're looking forward to more, and I'll be back very soon with more of Child's Play 2, the novelization. Also, before I go, I want to say thank you to Bonanza Jellybean for voicing Andy Barclay in tonight's upload and the entire book so far. Thank you so much for that. You're doing an amazing job. All right, guys, until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying thanks for listening, and you can't keep a good guy down.
'There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Human frame, a million candles burning for the love that never